Now in this video, let us look at the question number 51 to question number 60. So question number 51 says that CMOS stands for. So when I'm saying CMOS, CMOS means it is a complementary metal oxide semiconductor. It is not complete metal oxide semiconductor. It is not complex metal oxide semiconductor. It is complementary metal oxide semiconductor. Now question number 52 says the size of cache memory normally is. So generally the cache memory size is given in megabytes and register size is given in bytes. So normally the cache memory size is given in megabytes. That is why I can say that maybe the option number B can be a correct answer here, but it should not they should not ask these kind of questions at all, because cache memory size is generally 2 MBs, sometimes it is 3 MBs, sometimes it is 6 MBs. For high-end computers, they are 8 MBs of cache memory. This is only for high-end computers. And again, the cache memory can be of L1 cache, L2 cache, and L3 cache. So I would say this is a this is a kind of questions which should not be asked this way. Okay. So, but generally, the size of cache memory is in megabytes. Now, question number 53 says the digital logic circuit can be. So this digital logic circuit can be combinational circuit. It can also be sequential circuit. So I'll say option number C is the correct answer. So combinational circuits, like we have half adder, full adders, multiplexers, demultiplexers, these are the combinational circuits. And sequential circuits where we need to remember something. Remembering, for example, we have flip-flops. So any circuit that you are going to make using flip-flops, they are going to be sequential circuits because they need to store some kind of information. So option number C is the correct answer for this given question. Now let us look at the question number 54. It says flip-flop is. A flip-flop is generally used to store one bit of information, and it is also called as bistable multivibrator. So the answer to this is a bistable device. So it is, we should not give the name as electronics device. Obviously it is an electronic component, but flip-flop is a bistable multivibrator. It is used to store one bit of information, so we can say it is a bistable device. Now for question number 55, an integer can be represented as. An integer can be represented as 1's complement, 2's complement, as well as the sign magnitude representation. That depends on what kind of implementation you are doing. These 1's complement, 2's complement, all these things are used to represent negative numbers. So for example, there's a positive number, as I told you. We can have a positive number, we can have a negative number. We can use sign magnitude representation or 1's or 2's complement to represent negative numbers. So option number D is the correct answer to this given problem. Now, for question number 56. See, I'm feeling that I'm going very fast, so I'll try to go slow with you. So my aim is to solve as many problems as possible, so that is why I'm going fast. So it is my general tendency that I tend to go fast when I'm fully working. Okay. So question number 56 says an n-bit register means. When I'm saying n-bit register, now this n-bit register is generally means that it can have n flip-flop and registers has n bits. Why I'm saying n bit? Because see, registers are made up of flip-flops only, and it is a combination of some flip-flop. For example, there's some flip-flops they are used, and these flip-flops, every flip-flop is going to store one bit of information. So register, when I'm saying n bit register, that means it is going to have n flip-flop, as well as it is also means the register has n bits. So option number C is the correct answer to this given problem, which is saying both A and B is the correct answer. Okay. Now in the next question, they are saying how many 128x8 memory chips are needed to provide a memory capacity of 4096x16. Now you need to understand that we are not combining these chips. We are not making them as one byte. One device, you can see, you can assume it as a kind of a biscuit. So this is a biscuit. So you can combine these biscuits to create a huge device. For example, if this is 128x8, and this way we are going to have some combinations, maybe 10 or 15 or 16 combinations are there. Now accordingly, they are going to combine together to create a bigger memory capacity. Okay. Now here I'm just assuming that these can be same, but I'm just assuming here. So because it is 4096, I am just going to divide this 4096, or there's one more way of saying this. It's 128x8. That means we are going to have 128 cells. In every cell, we are going to store 8 bit of information. So you can say it is 128 is 2 raised to power 7 multiplied by 8 bits. 8 bits, or you can say 2 raised to power 3. That means we are storing 2 raised to power 10 bit of information in this. Now, when I'm saying 4096 multiplied by 16, this 4096 can be written as 2 raised to power 12, and this 16 can be written as 2 raised to power 4. So this is 2 raised to power 16, right? So we need to store 2 raised to power 16 bit of information. Now, for this particular case, if you go it like this, that for storing 2 raised to power 16 bit of information, and we need 2 raised to power, and every biscuit here or every cell, every memory location is storing 2 raised to power 10 bit of information, then we are going to require 2 raised to power 6 such memory locations, and 2 raised to power 6 means it is 64 in number. So answer to this question is option number B, which is saying 64 as a correct answer, because we need to store all, we need to make a combination of these biscuits, or you can say these memory chips, to create a bigger memory chips which stores this much of information. Okay, now see, for solving this kind of question, if you want to solve them fast, better is the best way if you remember the powers of two. That is, we already I've done so much practice that I exactly know what is the powers of two. I can write them in reverse order also. For example, I can say, when I'm saying power of 12, that means 2 to the power 12, that is 4096. 2 raised to power 11, that is 2048. 2 raised to power 10, it is 1024. 2 raised to power 9, it is 512. 2 raised to power 8, it is 256. 2 raised to power 7, it is 128. And 2 raised to power 6, it is 64, and so on. So better ways, if you remember these powers, then solving these kind of questions become very, very fast in the examination hall. It will be a matter of seconds for you to solve these kind of problems, okay? Now let us take the question number 58. It says, the operation of a digital computer is based on the operation of digital computers. Now these digital computers actually work on the principle of logics. That means you apply logics to perform the operations, okay? So counting principle is not a correct answer. Electronic principle again is not a correct answer. Why? Because we have electronic devices, but we don't have electronic principles. Electronic devices are there, electronic principles are not there, and missing principle obviously it is not a correct answer. There are logical principles. We apply logics to create programs and to create instructions, and how those instructions are followed, that totally depends on logic. So you can say that logic principles, operations of computers are based on logic principles. Now question number 59 says, the concept of stored program was introduced by Von Neumann. So that is why we also call it that Von Neumann architecture. Von Neumann architecture, that means you store the program and then you run the stored program. Okay, so it is not Charles Babbage, it is not Howard Akin, it is not Thomas J. Watson. So obviously you only know it cannot be Thomas J. Watson, and you need to search about these two people also. But we clearly know that Von Neumann, he introduced the concept of stored program architecture. So you can read about the stored program architecture here. Now, question number 60 says, the parity bit is in communication is used to find. See, this parity bit is used to find whether there is some kind of error in the delivered data or not. Okay, so this parity bit is stored something like this. For example, if let us say we send some bits, maybe 7 bits are there, 101101. So these are in total 7 bits. Now in this total 7 bits, how many number of ones are there, or how many number of zeros? According to that, we can set the parity bits. Let us say we want to set the parity bit according to the number of ones. So here there are 4 ones. So because there are even number of ones, so I'm going to use 0 as the parity bit. So this is called as even parity. And if the number of bits are like this, that means you can see there are odd number of ones. So we can set the parity bit as 1. So parity bit is used to find whether if this combination is received by the receiver. For example, there's a sender, there's a receiver. If the receiver is going to receive this combination, and if there's some kind of error introduced in this combination, maybe one bit is changed from 1 to 0, then by the help of parity bit, we'll be able to clearly identify whether there is some kind of error in the program or not. So parity bit is used to find whether error is there or not. Okay, so for the question number 60, you can see this is used to detect the errors. But when I'm saying one bit error detection, one byte error detection, one bit error correction, obviously error correction is not a correct answer here. Error detection is there, right? So we cannot have 1 byte error detection. We have 1 bit of error detection. Okay, so option number A is the correct answer for the question number 60. Now let us look at the question number 61.